Welcome to Generic Wrestling Podcast, starring me, Asterios Kokonos, and my friend Larnock the Destructor. Say, you could say hi now, I mean, or not.
Hi, everybody.
Yeah, look, he's saying hi. There's a lot of wrestling podcasts. We all listen to them. I'm guessing that a lot like me, you listen to the wrestling podcast, but you may not watch Monday Night Raw or SmackDown every week because you're a fucking adult and you're busy and it's 5 hours of bullshit. And, like, so I don't want to do a wrestling podcast where we're like, ooh, let's take apart a pay-per-view. I don't want to do a wrestling podcast where it's like, oh, let's talk about what happened this week. I don't want to do a wrestling podcast that's like, oh, here's what's happening on TNA. I'm sorry, Impact. You might not be watching Impact, but there's some good stuff happening on Impact. Here's what I want to do. Here's all that matters to me in this podcast. Pick'ems. There's a pay-per-view called Hell in a Cell coming up. Now, I want to know, we're going to go down the card, and me and Eric are going to pick who we think's going to win and who we think's going to lose. We're going to have points. We're going to keep track. And whoever has the least, whoever loses, it's like an Oscar pool, but for the pay-per-views every week. And whoever loses has to do a devilishly ironic punishment suggested by the other host, the fans, or both. Okay. And this is probably the first time I've explained this whole podcast to you. Like, do you understand it?
Yeah, I'm getting it now and realizing live in the moment the stipulations I am committed to.
What stipulation? What's the stip, chief?
This defeat, if I lose, because I'm pretty sure I'm not going to lose. I'm pretty sure I'm going to pick them to win them. But now I know the full stakes.
Yeah, and we'll figure out what the ironic punishment is, but let's start going through the card. Eric,
sure.
Would you mind pulling up the card, and can you lead us through it?
Yeah, I already have it pulled up.
Fuck yeah. All right, hold on. Let me see if I can get your sound to be just a tiny bit less choppy.
Give
me just one. It's entirely my fault. Okay, I'll close this. All right, that might speed things up. All right, what's the pre-show match or matches?
There's only one announced, and it's not a pre-show. It's a kickoff match,
I apologize.
A pre-show sounds really derogatory, but a kickoff is meant to get you whipped up in excitement. And that's the New Day defending the SmackDown Tag Team Championship against Rusev Day. I don't know if that's their actual tag team name, but we're just going to call them Rusev Day, which is Rusev and Aiden English.
With Lana.
Sure.
She'll be there. And look, she could hit someone with some brass knuckles like the Miz. No, she won't. She's a face. This is, interestingly, it's kind of tweener versus tweener because the New Day do cheat. Like, they will grab a handful of tights even when they're baby faces. And I love it. I'm like, yeah, why the hell not? Just do what it takes to win. I love you guys. You're throwing pancakes and your booty-os. And same thing with Rusev Day. It's like, they're not heels, but Rusev is fucking vicious to people. Like, what do you think? Do you think – who do you think's the face? Who do you think's the heel here, Eric, and why?
Well, Rusev is the heel because he's still Russian by proxy. He's Bulgarian, and then he represents Russia.
He loves Vladimir Putin. Remember when he pledged his allegiance to Vladimir Putin?
So just – he is still – always going to be Russian. So, it, you know, when in doubt, default to bad guy.
Okay.
And then if you were unsure about, like, oh, well, in this post-Trump world, maybe Russia are the good guys now, never forget that his tag partner is British. And he's a British theater actor. So he is 100% the bad guy.
And he's dating a Russian lady, the same Russian lady who told Rocky that he would die just like Apollo Creed died.
Yeah. He dies. and so the New Day, they're like, yeah, they cheat, but it's more in that, like, impish, cartoonish way that, like, Hornswoggle did.
Yes.
Where it's lovable.
Yes. Okay. Well, let's pick them. Rusev Day deserves – oh, you're going to be hearing this philosophy a lot from me because this is how I think I can win this podcast every month. Rusev Day needs the win. They need the titles. They are over with the crowd. The Rusev Day chants are getting a little bit weaker. Those calendars were great. Remember when they sold those calendars that every day is Rusev Day? That's great merch. So because they should win, by Vince logic, they're going to lose. And the New Day will retain. I don't think the WWE makes good decisions often. I think they're gonna be like, well, we just did this whole five timers thing club with the New Day. We can't just have them lose automatically. I mean, unless it were a schmoz and Rusev Day cheated, but I don't see them. They just did all that stuff where Aiden English kept accidentally screwing up. All right, I'm giving it to New Day. What do you think, Eric?
Okay, so here's where the game really gets interesting, because it isn't just about who wins and who loses these matches, but it's about how they win and lose.
True.
Because the thing to think about, and if you're not totally familiar with what is going on with WWE right now, I'd say it's probably one of the most fascinatingly bad times to be a WWE viewer. Because, you know, Vince McMahon is still producing the show, and he's like 89 years old. He's basically morphed into Izzy Mandelbaum from Seinfeld.
Mandelbaum.
Yeah. Come on, tough guy. It's go time. That's basically who is like writing and directing and producing these wrestling shows. And, you know, there's been all of these crazy anecdotes over the years of, you know, how Vince McMahon would produce and direct all of these famous vignettes in WWE history, you know, like with Ted DiBiase, the Million Dollar Man, and like all of the money he would like throw into those productions to make Ted DiBiase look like a guy who could literally just buy off a whole restaurant, you know. And he would always like shoot things really madcap and guerrilla style. You know, it's like that was his time to be Werner Herzog. So the thing about that is the pay-per-view finishes are Vince's time to act like a stage playwright. You know, like the vignettes are when he gets to be Scorsese, but the pay-per-view finishes are when he gets to be like, I'm a stage director. But like, imagine a world where like the only play that ever existed is Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, and you get an idea about like the execution of Vince's ideas for like
drama.
Well,
unfortunately, both the producers of Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark and Vince McMahon are responsible for the death of a man during a high wire stunt. Maxwell Silver just gave us $2. He says, just jump ship and watch New Japan like me. Eric watches... Eric's Mr. New Japan. This guy watches New Japan all the time. But Eric, the people want to hear your pick. What's your pick?
Okay, so that's... I wanted to give that preamble before I explain my picks for this show.
No. And by the way, let me just say this real quick. And I'm sorry. I'm cutting you off, Eric. I'm so sorry.
Sure.
Here's the dirt that I've heard. It's not on the internet. Literally right now, you guys are all about to get dirt. The reason SmackDown is good and Raw is bad is this. They get to the Raw town on Sunday. Vince is there all day on Monday, producing Raw, fucking Raw up, screwing Raw up. Vince is now, and I heard this from a guy in the business, Vince is now too old to then do SmackDown on Tuesday.
Yeah.
His body can't take it. Yeah, he took a lot of steroids. So he has to go home to Connecticut. That's why there's no like last minute weirdo rewrites to SmackDown, because they don't have Vince fucking it up. But on pay-per-view nights, just like Eric just said, Vince is there to screw up SmackDown's bookings. So it's like he gets one chance a month to fuck us.
Yeah. So it's like, think of if he is Izzy Mandelbaum, except for SmackDown when he's Morty Seinfeld at a 5 p.m. Jay Peterman meeting. And he's just too tired and he wants to rush through it and get home.
Mm-hmm.
So with that being said, now he's fresh. He's gotten his 3 hours of sleep before his 6 hour, 2 a.m. workout, before his 3 hours of business calls with Saudi Arabia. So what I am predicting is going to happen. I agree that the New Day will win. However, the New Day is going to win after the bar, Cesaro and Sheamus interfere and cost Rusev Day the match.
Oh, that's brilliant. Okay. Well, you know what? Yeah.
Because Rusev Day beat the bar this past week on Tuesday to earn this title shot. And the next WWE pay-per-view is really only like 3 weeks away. It's ridiculous. It's too soon. But they've already announced that the New Day are facing the bar on that show. So I think we are building to a culmination of the New Day, the bar, and Rusev Day.
You know what? Take the New Day out of it. I think that's absolutely brilliant. If you win that, you get a bonus point if you win that, if that's what happens for sure. Because that keeps it face versus face. The New Day doesn't, you know, it can be a good match. It'll be a short match because it's on the kickoff show. You know, like the bar interferes. That really does cement Rusev Day as faces. That's fantastic. Yeah. That's great. And that, I love the bar doing that too. Like, that's real good heel heat for the bar because people love Rusev Day. Gotta keep the heat on the baby faces. All right, so we got our picks. We're both saying Rusev Day, we're both saying New Day to win. Eric, it's a bonus point if it's through bar interference. Let's go to the chat real quick and say what they're, let's see what they're saying. Okay, what's happening? Maxwell Silver says, what the fuck is this show? You know, we're talking about wrestling.
He's trying to figure out your source for your wrestling rumors.
You actually would probably be able to know what my source was if you had, if you've listened to me for a couple of years, you know who I've talked about being friends with.
Oh, I sure do.
Grimpify says, what the hell is this? A wrestling podcast. Trey Enneman wants to know who's the best rapping wrestler of them all. Eric, your take? I mean, I think it's Hogan versus Macho Man, but you might know someone I don't know.
Well, it's not PN News.
What is that?
That was the rapping wrestler of WCW. But all he could do was go, yo, baby, yo, baby, yo, baby, yo.
Wait, was he like a Vanilla Ice wrestler?
No, he was this big dude. He was fat. He was in the same era as Van Hammer, the heavy metal guitar wrestler who couldn't play electric guitar, and the Dynamic Dudes, the blonde-haired California skateboard tag team that couldn't skateboard. So they had, like, this was the early 90s. They had heavy metal guitarists, skateboarders, rappers, but none of the wrestlers could do those things. So they would just, like, carry the props and say, like, one or two things, like a toy with a electronic voice box in it that can say like one or two phrases.
Eric, I just realized you're the David Shoemaker. And I'm the, what's his name? The other guy, Baldo, what's his name?
Oh, the shill. Who was totally co-opted by WWE.
Yeah.
In Hot 97.
Yeah. What's it? You're the shoemaker. You're the expert. I'm Mr. Zip Zap Zap. Oh, keeping the high energy. Blip, blop, bloop. We got a great dynamic. All right. Cheap Heat with Peter Rosenberg. Yeah. I'm also dating a girl out of my league. All right. You want to move on to the next match?
Sure.
All right. What's the next match, Eric? What do we got, Eric?
Okay, so now we're past the kickoff and we're on to the main show.
Yep.
And we just talked about the SmackDown tag titles. So let's talk about the Raw Tag Team Championship. It's Dolph Ziggler and Drew McIntyre defending against two-thirds of the Shield, Seth Rollins and Dean Ambrose.
Oh, shit, this is tough because, again, wrestling logic would tell you, fucking just keep them off the Shield because Rollins has the IC belt, right? Does he still have the IC belt?
He sure does, and he hasn't defended it in a while.
Yeah, and Reigns has the top title. Wrestling logic would tell you to just keep it on Ziggler and McIntyre because they could use the rub, which of course means that the Shield will win them and they'll be covered in gold. Like that one gif of Triple H that we all love where he's got all the belts and I got to give it to the Shield.
Okay.
Eric, what's your take?
I'm going to say that Ziggler and McIntyre retain.
Wow.
However, I don't see the Shield getting pinned anyway whatsoever. So I'm going to say Ziggler and McIntyre get the cheap heel win and win by disqualification.
You know what? Actually, I wish I could change my vote, but now I can't because here's what's going to happen. Like, the Shield is going to get screwed at this match by Braun Strowman's army of zombie jobbers that he has total control over, so that when Roman wins in the cage through Shield interference, it doesn't look cheap.
Yeah. I mean, I have different thoughts about the main event, but we'll get there.
We'll get there. Okay.
Yeah.
Maxwell Silver. Oh, she just gave us another super chat. He says, who's going to win World Tag League? Eric, your thoughts?
I don't even think they've announced opponents for it yet, but who even? Oh, the Young Bucks are the champs. So let's go with Evil and Sonata.
Yeah, well, Maxwell Silver, if you disagree with us, I'll let us know. And if you know who's in World Tag League, also let us know, anyone in the chat. Because this Eric guy, he bought a ticket to Bound for Glory.
Listen, man, don't try to embarrass me.
I'm so sorry. All right, what's our third matchup, Eric?
It's a mixed tag match. It's Daniel Bryan and his wife, Brie Bella, versus The Miz and his wife, Maryse.
I think that Brie Bella and Daniel Bryan have to win because they don't want Brie Bella losing on TV, because right now the Bella twins kind of have the invincibility star. Have you noticed this? Like,
sure.
They cannot lose. I was watching Raw the other day when Nikki Bella took out Ruby Riott. Again, makes no sense, but that's not – but you can't think about this as to what makes sense or what would make a better story. You got to think about this like, yeah, the Bellas are on TV right now. They need the pop, they need the wins. And but, man, when Nikki Bella won, the women in the audience cheered so loud. Because for 5 years, they've been watching the Bella Twins, and reality television has taught them, like, the Bella Twins are just like you. Like, they're dating a guy who's not ready to commit. You know, they're being underestimated. You know, they're beautiful, and people use that against them. They're being backstabbed. So when Nikki Bella won, I heard for the first time ever, like, a female-only pop, and I was like, they were right to put her over. So long story short, Bryan and Bella win because Maryse can eat the pin. Who gives a shit? Like that doesn't hurt anybody, and that doesn't stop the inevitable Bryan-Miz WrestleMania blow-off. Eric, what's your take?
Well, you gave a very impassioned presentation for why Brie Bella can't lose in this scenario, but there's one crucial detail you forgot.
Oh no.
Which is that her husband is Daniel Bryan, and Vince McMahon hates that liberal Pacific Northwest hippie vegan who voted for Jill Stein and ruined his WrestleMania 30 plans, and will take any chance he gets to strategically embarrass Daniel Bryan. So Daniel Bryan lost at SummerSlam, and I am predicting that Daniel Bryan and Brie Bella will lose again.
That's the – if you were going to have any reason to break their loss, it would be out of old man spite. That's fantastic. All right, let's go back to the chat. Is there anybody – what are these world tag – I'm not high, by the way, Max. I wish I was. I'm just honestly – this is like the first time I've talked to a real-life friend of mine in weeks. I've just been on Discord all the time, getting lawsuit sad. And so, like, I am happy that, like, Eric's here, my buddy Joni's in the chat, my best friend from a million years ago. Like, this is fucking fun. All right, anyway. All right, well, I guess we don't know who's there. But anyway, what's the next match, buddy?
Okay, so we're keeping it on SmackDown.
Yeah.
And that is the SmackDown Women's Championship.
Oh.
Charlotte Flair versus her former best friend, Becky Lynch.
So far, this is, I believe this to be the toughest match to pick. Do you agree or disagree so far?
I disagree.
Okay. All right. Well, why don't you take the lead this time? Who do you think is going to win?
Okay. So there's WWE Evolution. The first ever all women's pay-per-view happening in October.
Do you want to go to that, by the way? Isn't that like right around the corner from us? It's in Long Island.
But that requires going to Long Island.
We can pick strawberries.
Radiated strawberries.
That's true.
From 80s factories that declassified, deregulated all of their toxic waste.
Yeah, look, I'm from Long Island, and we have the highest incidence of breast cancer in the nation because of that. Also, our tides are brown. You remember that?
I think just everything is brown in Long Island.
Yeah,
like,
that's
true. It's just, if you say Long Island and the Rorschach test in my brain just goes to the color brown.
People always pick on New Jersey, and I'm always like, have you seen Long Island? It's like, the thing you think is New Jersey is actually Long Island. All right, but anyway, we're getting off topic. Tell me who wins, who loses. What you got, Eric?
So, point being, this will culminate in October, not this upcoming Sunday.
True.
So, I don't see a scenario. Here's my prediction.
Sure.
Charlotte Flair will not get pinned.
No. No, 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 no. She will not eat a pin at all.
Mm-hmm.
I think that Becky Lynch wins through cheating. Because, if she's going to literally say you people, they want her to be a heel. If she's going to hug someone in the ring and then give them whatever the female equivalent of a low blow is, they want her to be a heel. So
yeah. I'll add on to my prediction then.
Sure.
I'll take a gamble.
Okay.
I'm predicting Becky gets pinned. And then on Tuesday on SmackDown, the feud continues, even though the heel has already been beaten. And we just ignore the fact that the babyface already won.
That is stupid, so they would do it. No, that makes a lot of sense. Why would you pin her? There's a million ways to have neither of these people pinned. We're trying to build up Becky Lynch, so of course Vince would want her pinned, because she's got an Irish accent, and maybe he doesn't appreciate her cup size. Like, I'm into it, Eric.
He definitely doesn't.
I'm into it. Eric?
Yeah.
I love it. All right, so we're both giving it to Becky. And then,
no, I'm giving it to Charlotte. I'm going to say she gets pinned. I'll give it to Charlotte will pin Becky.
Sure.
You think Becky wins? I say Charlotte wins.
I thought you were pitching Dusty finish. Charlotte is pinned but somehow retains. I thought you were pitching a Dusty finish. No.
Yep.
It's a she lose. Wait, you're saying this Sunday Charlotte Flair walks out with the belt?
Clean. And the feud continues until next month.
That's so stupid. They would absolutely... Right. That is so dumb they would do it! Because time for her to get the belt is in Evolution! So why would they do that?
Right. Lloyd Mandelbaum thought tying Jerry up to a moving car was the best way to do cardio. Never underestimate the capacity for stupid decisions from the Mandelbaum family.
Eric, I think I'm going to lose this month. Your logic is too tight. All right, let's head over to the chat. Chat says Becky Lynch is going to win.
Mm-hmm.
Chat is saying that Chat says Lynch is going to win. Well, let's see.
Okay.
All right.
I think we're just going to get the female equivalent of LOL Cena wins.
Yeah. That's a good bet, man. You're very smart. All right, what's the next match?
All right, the next match is my personal main event. It's Jeff Hardy versus Randy Orton in the Hell in the Cell.
This is so hard to pick because I think it's I think it's as simple as LOL Randy wins. I think that Hardy gets to do his crazy ass swanton bomb off the top of the cell, which they find a way to kind of lower so it's safe, but they shoot it so it looks like it's way too high.
Yeah.
But even after getting that, I don't know if Orton wins through cheating or if Orton wins like through Nakamura. Look, Orton's going to win, man. Orton's going to win. What do you think?
Okay, so Orton's going to win.
Okay.
I agree with you. I agree with you all the way up to there, and I'm predicting that Orton wins clean.
Yeah! All right!
I don't think Nakamura is going to interfere, which is really funny that Nakamura isn't even going to be on this pay-per-view. I think that's the best thing possible, that the most popular, dynamic, charismatic Japanese pro wrestler who caught the attention of American fans.
And who also has a title.
And uprooted his entire family to move to the U.S. for this opportunity isn't even going to be on the pay-per-view after he lost at WrestleMania and then all of the pay-per-views after WrestleMania.
And got bit by that dog.
Yeah.
Even after getting bit by that dog, put him on the show, he got bit by that dog. All right. Yeah. I'm also going to say, I don't want to look like I'm stealing your bullshit here. I'm also going to say Orton wins clean, though, because if Orton was going to win clean over Bray Wyatt when Bray Wyatt desperately needed the pin, desperately needed the win all those times, why would they change it now? Yep. All right. Sounds like this one we are both on the exact same page.
Mm-hmm. So I have a question for you.
What do you got?
About the finish of this match.
Sure.
We all know Hardy is going to do a swanton bomb off of the top of the Hell in the Cell.
Mm-hmm.
And then we all know he's going to miss.
Yes! Oh my god, yes! And then that's how Orton fits.
Is that the end of the match? Or does Orton still find a way to drag an unconscious Jeff Hardy and RKO him?
No, that's not the end of the match. Okay, you're right. Does the swanton bomb off the top of the thing? By the way, the whole time Mick Foley is telling him, please don't do this. Because let's not forget, listeners, Mick Foley is now the special guest referee. Bang, bang! And he really shoved that in Elias's face for some reason. And he's like, Elias, I bet you don't like that. I'll be the guest referee. And it's like, What? Why would Elias care either? Anyway, I love Elias, by the way.
I love him too, which is why he's also not on the show.
No, of course not. Why would we want to see a guy who we love and is over with the crowd wrestle when he could just do the same bit every time, like the fucking Spartans in SNL? Why don't we just see this 17 times until we're all tired of him, like we tired of poor sweet Sherry O'Terry? But anyway, he's about to jump. Mick's begging him, don't do it. He does it. He misses. Orton drags him back in the ring. 1, 2, Hardy gets the hand up, and ooh, that's essentially Vince giving him a win, is that he still, and then they have to do the RKO to put him away, and Mick Foley counts a begrudging 3.
Okay.
What do you think?
Interesting. I like it.
You don't think he's going to RKO in midair off the top of the cage, do you?
No, but I
because that would totally steal focus from that spot.
No, also, I don't think – I guarantee if there's any wrestler in the WWE who gives less of a fuck and has the clout to insist that he's not going to give the full effort, it's Randy Orton.
Yep.
So he's not going to be involved in Jeff Hardy's very real dangerous stunt in any way, shape, or form. He's going to get out of Dodge for real as fast as possible. Even though this will be a controlled stunt with crash pads, there's no way Randy Orton is going to, like, even get a whiff of the wind from Jeff Hardy falling from a 20-foot cage.
You're absolutely fucking right. This is why we have this guy in the show. He's our shoemaker. All right, let's zip through these last couple of matches so we can spend a lot of time on the final.
We got three.
All right.
We've got the Raw Women's Championship, which is Ronda Rousey defending against the former champ, Alexa Bliss, in a SummerSlam rematch.
I'm going to give it to Rousey because it further destroys Bliss's character, and that's what they – like, I think that they're – in their mind, they're like, Bliss is over no matter what. She can talk. Rousey can't talk. We're trying to build Rousey up as, like, the bionic female redneck in the media. Like, Bliss can eat the pin. Maybe this time Bliss actually gets some offense in. Maybe this time Bliss gets some help from Alicia Fox and
Mickey James.
And Mickey James. But no, she's not going to lose. She's not going to lose. They want the title on Rousey for Evolution because they want her out in the press with the belt. What do you think?
Yeah. I also agree that Alexa Bliss is definitely going to lose.
Okay.
I think she's going to do whatever she's asked to do to get annihilated by Ronda Rousey, and in return, she gets to beat Trish Stratus next month at Evolution.
That's brilliant. That's absolutely brilliant. Mm-hmm. Because Trish Stratus can put up a valiant effort, and they can kind of Daniel Bryan Trish Stratus. Of course, I mean pre-WrestleMania 30 Daniel Bryan, where like they'll say, Trish, you can lose, but you'll always be over. Like, that's the speech they'll give her before she goes out there and puts over a woman who's probably going to be saying some pretty horrible things about her appearance in the run-up to Evolution.
Yeah, and then she'll probably post some very Trump-sounding statements on her personal Instagram stories.
Who? Which one? Bliss or?
I'm talking Alexa Bliss.
Oh! Okay, because I think what Trish Stratus will post after is, like, maybe, like, a cut on her forehead and be like this ain't a game, but I've been playing it the longest, and like for all you little girls out there, I just want you to know that if you get in there and you fight, you're the winner no matter what. Like, hashtag Team Stratus, hashtag Stratus faction, not hashtag blow you into the stratosphere though. No.
I want to know what actress that's old. That Alexa Bliss will compare Trish Stratus to in order to shame her for being an older woman.
Yup. That's what's going to happen. It's going to be bad. It's going to be bad. But hey, be a star, kids. All right, what's next?
Okay, so now we've got the sub-main event, if you will. It's the WWE Championship, AJ Styles versus Samoa Joe, and I just want to clarify, it's AJ Styles and Samoa Joe, and it is not in the Hell in the Cell.
Right, because...
Because when you have a personal rivalry, that they literally, the referees have to separate them, and the good guy champion in the family man has been driven to such violence, emotional heated violence, that he gets himself disqualified and uses weapons. There's only one way to settle that kind of blood feud, and that's a traditional wrestling match.
I can't top any of what you said. I can't yes and that. You've already took it home. That's brilliant. Who are you picking, buddy?
Okay, he's going to win.
Oh, I'm sorry. You just cut out. Can you take that one more time? You just cut out. Sorry.
Sure. It's going to be AJ Styles. And it's funny. This is basically the TNA division of WWE.
Yeah.
And that we've got AJ Styles and Samoa Joe. And Samoa Joe loses because he's just like the monster of the month. And then he sort of becomes the Abyss of WWE.
Yeah.
And that Abyss was to TNA as Samoa Joe will be to WWE. It's like poetry.
It rhymes. Even though they already have Abyss, because remember when they put Hardy in... Is Hardy still rocking the face paint? Isn't he?
He sure is.
God damn it.
And he's also doing his aluminum foil art and his motocross.
And his first and last ever DUI. Okay. Oh, by the way, when he said that in an interview, I was like, I'm going to remember that talking point in case I ever get a DUI. I'll be like, yep, it was my first and last ever DUI. It's like, what the fuck did... What? But it's so smart. It's very... It's like... That's very convincing.
See, the other ones were DWIs. So technically, he's telling the truth.
Oh, my God. I love wrestling. I'm going to give it to AJ because AJ is, much like Randy Orton... A bulletproof Cena. I wish they could find a way to... I mean, I think they're going to give it... I think much like Eric said with Charlotte and Becky, I think AJ's going to win, but they're going to continue their feud as if nothing had happened, and the announcers are going to be like, wow, now Samoa Joe's really pissed. Yeah. Now Samoa Joe's going way too far. I don't know if Samoa Joe DDPs the Undertaker's wife, like, starts showing up with a hidden camera. And I don't know if they go stalker, but wait, what do you think they'll do?
That's a good idea because that's totally the wrong character for Samoa Joe.
Yup.
So they should definitely make him do that.
Yeah. Yep. All right.
In fact, uh-huh. I predict... that they bring in Samoa Joe's real-life wife, acknowledge how she is unattractive to Joe, and explain why Joe is obsessed with AJ's wife.
I want to make sure I heard you correctly. They're going to bring in Samoa Joe's real-life wife.
Mm-hmm.
And then
mm-hmm. And then we're going to see that, like, oh, she's hideous. Can you blame Samoa Joe for being obsessed? Can you blame Samoa Joe for being obsessed with AJ Styles' wife now?
Yep, that sounds disgusting enough to be on television. All right, yeah, so we're both picking Styles, and it sounds like we're both saying if it's not clean, it's pretty clean. Yeah, I don't think they're going to do Samoa Joe the service of giving him a disqualification. Because the last match ended in a DQ.
Mm-hmm. And then so naturally, when the last match ended in a DQ and you're like, oh, I feel ripped off that I spent $60 on this show to see this big marquee main event and they didn't give me a finish. Well, hopefully I get my money's worth next month at the Steel Cage pay-per-view.
Right, where they're not in a steel cage. All right, we have reached our final. We've reached the biggest match. This is... Mm-hmm. This is Strowman Roman inside a cell, a structure mm-hmm. where Strowman can finally have Roman to himself, a structure that bodes no interference at all, ever, and there has never been interference in it, and there never will be. You know, you've gone first these last couple times, so I'll go first on this one.
Sure.
I mean, it's got to be Roman. They didn't just give him the belt for nothing. Mm-hmm. It sucks that Strowman loses his Money in the Bank briefcase, but I think their logic is, well, he didn't need it anyway. And it's like, well, if he didn't need it anyway, then why did you give it to him? You stupid, stupid idiots who can't... You're all on the list. I think there's a shitload of schmozziness. Literally, everyone breaks into the ring. It's like, Zig... It turns out that the Shield are in all black outfits and they've been clinging to the top of the ring the whole time. And at some point they drop down like ninjas when Ziggler and Ragnar get into the ring and... Fuck it, even Constable Corbin takes a bump this time. Fuck it.
Interesting.
But Roman wins. I'm praying to God that you could find a way where you could tell me I'm wrong.
Well, Mick Foley is the special guest referee for this match.
Oh, that's right.
And I think there's a reason for that. There's, much like Charlotte, there's no way Roman Reigns is getting pinned.
Right.
I still can't predict if Vince McMahon is ready to have Braun Strowman get pinned yet. And that's why I think Mick Foley is there. And I think Mick Foley is there to decide the finish of the match. And that I think further rendering the Hell in the Cell stipulation irrelevant, Mick Foley will stop the match due to an unprecedented level of violence that not even he has seen in the Hell in the Cell. That will be entirely bloodless, will not have thumbtacks, will have maybe one table bump for Dolph Ziggler, and then maybe a ladder shot for Drew McIntyre. And then Mick Foley will be like, this violence is too much. When I took my death-defying fall 20 years ago in the Hell in the Cell, I never knew that the violence would reach these heights. Wait, and so he stops the match.
Wait, Eric, to close our episode, let's play that old improv game where you go line for line. And let's do the Monday after Hell in a Cell's Foley promo where he explains. So I think, and let's just cut to the fun part where he's screaming, where he's like, you people don't know what it's like! My career got ended! I didn't want to see that same thing happen to you two kids!
All six of these WWE superstars have a future, and I didn't want to be the man responsible for cutting those futures short.
I can't even bend over to tie my own shoes! I'm not going to let the same happen to you two!
If you want to know why I stopped that match, you're damn right I stopped that match.
Yes. I stopped that match! Right here! Wait, where are they?
Right here in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Okay, and then
I don't know if that's where Raw.
Well, that's fine. That's fine. That's absolutely fine. And then Strowman gets right in Foley's face and goes, "You cost me my briefcase. You cost me my title. Now I'm gonna cost you your ability to walk." And he starts. Yeah, keep going. We're trading off.
Big Foley can't actually take a bump.
No, he can't. No.
So this will happen where Strowman, Ziggler, and McIntyre take him out. Ziggler and McIntyre are there to be henchmen, but Strowman will be the one that takes him out. But this will be done backstage because Mick Foley can't take a bump for real. So it'll be backstage, and it'll be done with lots of camera cuts and edits. And this will be another chance for Vince McMahon to produce and direct one of his Scorsese-like vignettes where Braun Strowman takes out Mick Foley by putting him in his car and then flipping it over into a dumpster that was on the lower level of the parking lot.
It has been a while. I was just thinking to myself, you know, it's been a while since Braun Strowman flipped something or pulled something down on someone with a cable. That the last time Foley got hurt on Raw, that's exactly what they did. They did the shaky cam thing, and then we cut to commercial. We cut back. Foley's on a stretcher being taken out. Yep. Yep. And now for the honor of Mick Foley, hey, wow, we actually found a way to put some emotion into this match between Strowman and Roman. Yeah, we had to cart out Mick Foley to do it, but goddamn, they found it.
Mm-hmm. And then we'll just see this rematch with The Shield and Strowman, Ziggler, and McIntyre 70 more times before the Royal Rumble.
Yep, yep, that makes sense to me. All right, so I'm picking Roman to win. I'm picking Roman to win. Eric's picking a no finish, essentially. The match gets called off. That's brilliant.
Yeah, something dramatic. A scene. I'm predicting a scene.
God damn it. I think I'm going to... Okay. Tiebreaker.
Mm-hmm.
Tiebreaker question. Who wins in Australia, Undertaker or Triple H, and why?
Oh,
and I'll let you take first bet at this.
Oh, this is like... It's own whole topic, and with every week my answer changes.
Do you want to wait till the next episode to really get into it?
Yeah, I think we should.
Okay.
I think this is a own main event discussion, and what better way to tease the second episode of this new show?
Yeah. We're such great bookers. All right. Before we go, Maxwell Silver in the chat wants to know, what does he think of New Japan's long game with the IC title being on Jericho? Eric, your thoughts?
I guess Jericho versus Naito in the Tokyo Dome in January. But I'd like to see something a little bit more surprising, like Jericho versus Okada.
Okay. Well, hey, what the hell? I haven't watched All In. What was up with his, like, weird skull face? Like, what's Jericho doing with that? Was he huffing paint and backstage? What's happening there?
Oh, he did something amazing.
Oh!
And yeah, he has now gained some quasi-Undertaker-like powers, where Kenny Omega beat Pentagon in his match, and then the lights went out. And everyone was getting amped because all the lights are going to come back on and someone's going to be standing in the ring. Who is it? And lights came back on and there was no one in the ring. And Kenny Omega just shrugged. And then slowly the defeated Pentagon stood up, but he looked slightly different. His tattoos were different. He had a noticeable beer gut, which he didn't used to have.
His chest was saggy.
He was wearing those really cringy metal bracelets that the guys from Motley Crue wear, and he attacked Kenny Omega, and he ripped off his mask and revealed that it wasn't Pentagon. It was Chris Jericho. And then Chris Jericho laid down the challenge for Kenny Omega for a rematch on the Chris Jericho Rock and Wrestling Cruise.
Can we go? How much are tickets to that?
I'm sure they are exorbitantly expensive for the luxury of being trapped in international waters for 5 days with wrestling fans.
All right, we got to look into tickets to that. Because just the other day, Sriracha was like, have you ever been on a cruise? And I was like, no. And I'd like to go on a cruise once, and I've never seen a Kenny Omega match even on video, so it would be cool for my first Kenny Omega match to be on a cruise. Well, hey, that's all the time we've got this week for Generic Wrestling Podcast. We got my buddy here, Larnock the Destroyer. Yeah, I'm your boy Asterios Kogodos. If you want to get to help us out, you can kick in a couple of bucks with some super chats. You can kick in a couple of bucks over at patreon.com/Asterios, and hopefully you can help us get on this wrestling cruise. My goodness. Oh, Maxwell Silver says it's like $800 for tickets. Well, enjoy the wrestling cruise, everybody. You will not see Asterios Kogodos on the wrestling cruise, but you will see us here next time to find out who wins.